Hello, good afternoon, friends. And today's last session, we have here Professor Manorama Patil, who is an architect and academician with 16 years of teaching experience in architectural education, worked as a MARCH coordinator and also guided for this thesis, accredited professional IGB, Indian Green Building Council, published various papers in various conferences and journals. She is practicing architect, successfully completed various residential, commercial, and institution projects, nominated to various committees as subject expert for Shivaji University and Council of Architects. Worked as CAP director for Shivaji University, Kolhapur. Manorama Patil is pursuing her PhD at JJTU University, and very soon that also would be awarded. Today's guest, Manorama Patil, Professor Manorama Patil, is going to deal with AI, artificial intelligence, and real estate management. Whereas real estate itself is a real, actual thing, though we are virtually connected, but she has brought the dimension of artificial intelligence and how all of you, all of us, can explore artificial intelligence in near coming future on in the field of real estate management. This session is sequentially arranged after the BIM one, the one which you had with Pallavi Shinde Madam, because then it will have some good connect and you can relate it also properly. After the session, you can feel free to interact with Manorama Patil Madam and explore more, enlighten more. If there is any difficulty also, you can message in the chat box. So now, I request, I welcome Manorama Patil Madam here for this session on behalf of Atal Academy team as well as cyber team and all of you. At the same time, without wasting much of the time, I request her to start with her session, AI, artificial intelligence and real estate management. Over to you, Professor Manorama Patil.
Good afternoon, everyone. Before beginning with the presentation, I would like to express my gratitude to Cyber College, the whole team for working for this FDP, and especially Dr. Parizat sir for giving me an opportunity for and adding me and inviting me to this Atal mission of FDP, which is a very mammoth work done by the Government of India under the Atal FDP. And I think I had heard during the opening sessions that it has already crossed 1,000 plus FDP programs, which is worth applauding. The aim of the presentation is to make, basically my presentation is to make acquaint with the current technological happenings which are there in relation to AI and the real estate industry. So let's begin with the presentation. So once again, I'll welcome with for this session, that is AI. We all are acquainted with AI, that is artificial intelligence and real estate management. So here, the session is divided into two parts. The first part will be discussing about the journey of AI, the historical events that marked its beginning from antiquity till date, and the future roadmap to AI. How AI will provide us with a valuable tool to augment human efforts to come up with the solutions to the vexing problems in almost all sectors, including the construction industry and the real estate industry. AI is everywhere. We now live in an age of big data, an age in which we have the capacity to collect huge sums of information that are too cumbersome for a person to process. So definitely we'll have, the AI will come to our rescue. The application of AI is, in this regard, has been quite fruitful in several industries, such as technology, banking, marketing, and entertainment. Other sectors have used AI and other technologies to transform their productivity performance. Though the construction industry and the real estate, in comparison, has progressed at a glacial pace. The global construction industry has grown only 1% per year, and in the past few decades, in comparison to 3.6 in the manufacturing and 2.8% for the whole world economy. The reason being, it is the most under-digitized industries in the world and is slow to adopt new technologies. This is as per the McKinsey report. That's why the reason why I have chosen AI and the various transformation digital we will require as a stakeholder. Nonetheless, stakeholders can no longer offer to see AI as a pertinent only to other industries. Real estate will need to catch up with AI methods and application. That is the only way to contend with the upcoming market competition and to remain relevant. So we need to prepare our teams for new world of work, the world of automation, robotics, and augmented reality. Sorry. We need to understand that the which ways we will need or fade away as employees return to the work in a mix of this traditional, remote, and hybrid settings. So we'll come, these are some beautiful, we can say, productions or quotes, which many stalwarts working into the giant techs have made, out of which we can say Mark Zuckerberg has told about AI. He says, in a way, artificial intelligence is both closer and farther away off than we imagine. AI is closer to being able to do more powerful things than most people expect. So there are enormous contributions of AI in each and every field, but still Mark Zuckerberg says that we are still out of reach of this real intelligence. But then 2 days back, I guess, there was a news from Tesla where Elon Musk has said that in near future, maybe we'll be successful in planting a chip into human brain. So I think the real intelligence is not that far away. There are many other quotes which you can see later on as I'll share the PPT. So the quest of artificial intelligence is a story of dreams and began with dreams, as all quests do. So it was this story of artificial began with Aristotle, perhaps the greatest of the thoughts, which was described in his book, The Politics. I would just like to read from him. For suppose that every tool we had could perform its task, either at our bidding or itself, perceiving the need, if like self-moved, they enter the assembly of gods. So here Aristotle is trying to say that it would be very convenient if the machines could perform their task, maybe at the bidding of a human being or maybe at himself. This dream has, as you can say, is into realization today. So we would have no need of servants, nor masters or slaves. Later on, Leonardo Vinci had sketched designs for a humanoid in the year 1495. He thought of tools that could perform tasks at our bidding. So we really don't know whether, or we are not sure whether this realization of Leonardo Vinci came into actual realization. But then, though he visioned of a knight or a humanoid robot who could set up, move its arms and heads. Several people constructed actual automata that moved in a lifelike ways. The most sophisticated was the mechanical duck, which could quack, flap its wings, paddle, drink water, eat and digest grain. So this was by, I guess the name was Jacques, who displayed his masterpiece in an event. He was a French inventor. We'll move on to the next slide. Robots in fiction, where it was Frank Borman in 1900 invented one of the literally world's most beloved robots, that is the in the Wonderful Wizard of Oz. I think people of my generation must have read the series of this Wonderful Wizard of Oz. It was this mechanical tinswood who was in search of the heart. Not only in fiction, but in real life, these things were supposed to become reality soon. Some 17 years later, Frank Baum, Joseph Chapek, wrote the story Opilek describing automatons. Joseph, with his brother Carl Chapek, introduced the term robot in the RUM, that is Rosen's Universal Robot. This is when we started having humanoids with brains, Alberti, in fiction. Rosen's Universal Center robot centered around a mad scientist who tried to unspur the powers of God, for man has acquired the technology and intelligence to create. Not in fiction, but in reality, two important tortoises like robots revolutionized the growth of AI. It was in 1948 that Dr. W. Gray Walter was interested if robots could model brain functions. He built two small robots called tortoises and named them Elmer and Elsie, a marvel of the day. This was the most revolutionary thing to happen. It was about the Elmer and Elsie that they did not have any brains or pre-programming. It had only a basic analog circuit, vacuum tubes, a touch and light sensor that they could recharge on their own once the battery was over. Perhaps this was the turning point in the history of the quest for artificial intelligence. Then what is artificial intelligence? The question comes. Slides. Artificial intelligence is the ability of machines to seemingly think for themselves. Artificial intelligence is demonstrated when a task performed by a human and thought of as requiring the ability to learn, reason, solve problems are done by a machine. A provisional answer could be following. AI is a field devoted to building artifacts capable of displaying in controlled, well-understood environments and over a sustained period of time, behavior that could be considered to be intelligent, or more generally, behaviors that are at the heart of what it is to have mind. Two things are very important in this working definition of AI that we go forward with. We need to look at a behavior that we considered to be intelligent. There may be anything of a human brain here, but then we also look at a behavior that we believe that is at the heart of it, and we need to have a mind or a brain. So this gave rise to further questions, namely, what exactly constitutes intelligent behavior? What it is to have a mind, and how humans actually manage to behave intelligently? In fact, it is very difficult. So this is a quadrant wherein we have these four things, that is the four dimensions of AI, which we adopt for artificial intelligence, that is think humanly, think rationally, acting humanly, and acting rationally. So I'll further elaborate this. In fact, it is very difficult to separate out the growth of cognitive science and the growth of AI. Each have lent help to other, and their history is intertwined. In fact, my very careful philosophical contemplation of that question has influenced the course of AI itself. So we'll move on to the questions. So these are what it is, think like human, which we talk about the behavior. I think, sir, the slides are running. Some slides are missing. It's running. Yeah, I think the questions got run off. Okay, yes. Now I'm okay. Now it's okay. So actually, it's okay, fine. Sorry for disturbance. There was a not syncing between the slides and my talk.
Speech.
Yeah.
Is it okay now?
Yeah, it's okay. Fine. So what exactly? So we are to look upon the three questions which we saw earlier. Okay, 1 minute. It's because of the PDF the slides are running, right? Okay. So we'll look at the third questions. How humans exactly manage to behave intelligently. So this we have already discussed, the four dimensions and what they exhibit. Okay. So yes. Some issues are there. Okay. How humans actually manage to behave intelligently? This question is empirical and is predominantly for psychology and cognitive science to answer. However, this question is pertinent. This is because any insight into human thought might help build machines that work similarly. So we'll move on to the next question. Okay. What it is to have a mind? The question on what it is the mark of the mental is philosophical. Thrust on artificial intelligence has lent significant urgency to it. Careful philosophical contemplation of this question has influenced the course of artificial intelligence. And lastly, what exactly constitutes intelligent behavior? The first question of specifying precisely what it is to do to count an intelligent behavior has traditionally been met by proposing particular behavioral test whose successful passing would signify the presence of intelligence. So we have discussed this slide. I'll just move on. So let us look at these dimensions of AI vis-a-vis the three questions. So we have the four different things involved. It would be think when someone is thinking, when someone is acting, or it is giving a rational behavior, or it is giving a human behavior. So an AI system will either fall into one of the four ways of looking at the things. Therefore, we could have systems which would be thinking humanly or thinking rationally or acting rationally and acting humanly. Think like human, when we say, we mean we need to model human cognition. Think rationally would involve formalizing the inference process. To act rationally would mean doing the right thing always. And the fourth, act like human, involves exhibiting human behavior. Thinking like human involves modeling human cognition and is an area that has been looked at very closely by the information processing community with psychology and has got huge push from the cognitive revolution. It requires scientific theories of internal activities of the brain. In fact, Newell and Simon in their GPS, that is the general program solver, is a kind of this type of intelligence. The GPS developed in 1957 by Alan. Okay. The GPS problem solver developed in 1957 by Alan Newell and Herbert Simon embodied a grand vision of a single computer program that could solve any problem given a suitable description of the problem. It thought of a single, as I said, it did cause a quite stir when it was introduced, and many people felt it could sweep in a grand new era of intelligent machines. It is a different story that it did not happen the way it was hoped to contribute. Think rationally. That is nothing but formalizing the inferences process. The next dimension. So in fact, this area where several Greek scholars which developed the various forms of logic, notion, and rules of derivations of thought. They may or may not have proceeded to the idea of mechanization of these processes, but the very idea of formalizing the inference process as a direct line to mathematics and philosophy to modern AI. In fact, Aristotle has a huge contribution. Aristotle considered rationality to be an essential characteristic of human mind. Perhaps the deepest contribution of Aristotle to AI was the idea of formalization, notion that remains at the heart of contemporary computational theory of mind and what we will see later to be as a strong AI. So let me explain this with an example, the syllogism of Aristotle. All computers use energy. Using energy always generates heat. Therefore, all computers generate heat. So this rise gives two main obstacles to this logistic approach in building program to create intelligence. Number one, not all intelligent behavior is mediated by logical deliberations. If anything is logical deduction, question is, what is the purpose of thinking? What thought should I have? Informed knowledge is not precise, and therefore, under a logical premise, it is difficult to model uncertainty. The theory and practice of putting everything with a logical system is hard to put together for real life problems. Next question, act rationally, that is nothing but doing things or focus attention on doing the right things. Now, many of our rational acts do not necessarily involve thinking. Most of the bionic reflexes that we do, for example, slipping of a glass. If you take an example, if it is slipping from a hand, we try to re-grasp that glass without thinking that what we have to do. So they do not necessarily involve thinking. It is definitely more general that the logical approach and amiable to scientific development than approaches based on human behavior or human thought. However, achieving perfect rationality is complex environment is not possible. This is because of high computational demands that such system put. The last dimension, that is act like human or showing human behavior. It's like creating machines that perform functions that require intelligence when the same tasks are performed by people. There are a number of capabilities to be incorporated in such systems that need to be acting like human. They include things like natural language processing, knowledge representation, automated reasoning, machine learning, computer vision, and robotics. It was Alan Turing who published his landmark paper in which he speculated about the possibility of creating machines with true intelligence. Sorry, it's running the slide. So this was a turning point. The Turing test, or the intimation game as it was called, is the paper which was put forth as a simple test that could be used to prove that machines could think. The Turing test involves about interrogating humans with a machine and with a human. So the person who is interrogating is unaware of whom he gets the response from. So this is the human interrogator, and then he's dealing with the human in person and a machine. So he's really unaware of whom he gets the response from. If the interrogator is not able to distinguish the responses received from the man or the system is said to be artificial intelligence. I think apart from these simple questions, we have moved ahead. Gary Kasparov has played with chess with the machine, and the machine has outputted it. Recently, I just 2 days back, I read into a news that there was a competition held for farming, where the comparison between a traditional farmer and the AI infused farming was done. And definitely the answer, as you have all guessed right, it was the artificial intelligence which has outwitted the human. So there are, apart from this simple interrogation, we have moved ahead with such activities. So Turing has also a lot of contribution apart from this in the history of AI. Turing and his fellow code breakers were actually pitted against the Nazi code machine Enigma. They performed a right answer, or found a right answer often enough and fast to be in real time. In fact, without such machines, German U-boats would have decimated to the North Atlantic. We are now able to talk of the early days of AI. So from literature to the actual AI, which began in 1956. With the Dartmouth conference. So having looked at this dimension, having looked at the general growth of AI, in late 1955, Alan Newell and Herbert Simon developed the logic theorist. This can be considered as the first AI program. The program representing each problem as a tree model, attempt to solve it by selecting the branch that would most likely result in the correct conclusion. However, it was in 1956 that John McCarthy organized the Dartmouth Summer Research Project on Artificial Intelligence. And in fact, from that point on, the field came to be known as artificial intelligence. This conference served to lay the groundwork for future AI research. The term AI was first used in this document. They say it, and I read for you. We propose that a 2-month, 10-man study of artificial intelligence to be carried out during the summer of 1956 at Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire. The study is to proceed on the basis of the conjecture that every aspect of learning or any other feature of intelligence can in principle be so precisely described that a machine can be made to simulate. This is where we have now looked at the dimensions of AI and have realized that we could either think humanly, think rationally, and act humanly. This leads us to two distinct concepts of AI. Yeah, before moving on to this concept of weak AI and strong AI, this is the picture of the conference, and these are the stalwarts which has contributed or reworked or groundwork for this beginning of artificial intelligence. So what do you mean by weak AI and strong AI? Weak AI aims at building machines that act intelligently without taking a position on whether or not the machines are actually intelligent. Whereas in opposite to that, strong AI, what we talk about real intelligence or human-like intelligence, is a field devoted to building persons, which we are very far from achieving, the strong AI. But maybe this reality with the Tesla's experiment could come into reality soon. However, the ultimate goal of AI, which we are very far from achieving, is to build a person, or more humbly, an animal. Their brand of AI is so called the Strong AI, an ambitious form of the field, aptly summed up by Hoglund. The goal of work, as per Nielsen Niels, the goal of work in artificial intelligence is to build machines that perform tasks normally requiring human intelligence. Whether it copies the human way intelligence work is not clearly specified, but we will love to have it perform tasks that would require intelligence. Now, to sum up, let us look at the brief history of AI and try to understand how the area has evolved. The enthusiasm continued for a decade from 1955 to 65 with the Dartmouth meeting that came to the term of AI. Very shortly after this, in 1995, it was a turning point when AI started to be accepted as science. During this period, there was integration of learning, reasoning, knowledge representation. AI methods started to be used in vision language, data mining, and a lot of others real-life problems. Up till 1985, AI researchers was involved with this initial euphoric concepts. Beyond 85, machine learning took over the area of AI roughly. This period of AI can be categorized as narrow AI, that is from 1980 up till 2020. So we are in a general AI thing, which is very unknown to us. We'll talk of that. So it can be categorized as narrow AI, AI with a very focused attention problems, which are really, really focused and do not talk of general AI concept. It is expected that as we make more progress in machine learning, we would be able to apply. Pardon, any problem? Okay. It is expected. नहीं मैं आता लास्ट चल स्लाइड पर आई एक्चुअली प्रॉब्लम इज हैपनिंग की ते स्किप व्हाय लागले स्लाइड पीपीटी म्हणून या इट्स रिस्पोंडिंग या वन स्लाइड डिफरेंस या सो आई एम एक्चुअली ऑन द लास्ट स्लाइड
ओके
या
प्लीज कैरी
या सो इट्स जस्ट अ समेशन ऑफ हाउ वी मूव फ्रॉम एआई विद द इनिशियल कांसेप्ट टू नैरो एआई एंड देन टू द जनरल एआई. So it is expected that we make more progress in machine learning, we would be able to apply intelligence to any problem near human intelligence and would go back to a general AI problem. But it is very uncertain what would happen. But I think here I'm saying that it is unknown. And again, I'm repeating the news which Tesla has put up. That it has been successful in implanting human chip one part of it here into the humans. So it would be able that we'll not need any external devices to talk to computers. So we can give direct orders to the computer. So I think in near future, this unknown path also will be known. So this is what is to sum up with the basic history of AI, the dimension, what the AI has to contribute, and the systems which fall under these dimensions. So let's move on to the next part of the session, that is real estate and digitization. Digitization has already begun in 2002, but with this pandemic, it has accelerated its growth. So here I would like to say that if you do not, or if you're not growing and adapting, you are dead. Modern real estate is so dynamic and competitive. The massive shift towards e-services and e-commerce and digital connectivity are redefining what resilience means in the 21st century. If COVID-19 has taught us anything, it is that this pandemic is a dress rehearsal for the most urgent crisis of all, that is climate change. The legacy of COVID-19 has made an impact on the spatial structures of the cities. Remote working will remain proper or popular to some workers and their employers, which will decrease the need for commercial space or central location and increase the demand for housing. There are many more models, new business models, which we need to adopt, such as shared working and space as service, or the use of data analytics that will accelerate the growth. Shared space and space as service are likely to be increased by 30% by the corporate portfolios, and they will move into these flexible work spaces. So it's really urgent as stakeholders that we make changes into our business models. If you operate in this real estate sector, opening your doors to these business models can allow dynamic growth and get you ahead in the competition. Yes, that's what Industry 4 has to offer with the various tools. So we should get adaptive and acclimatized with all these things. So these are some of the tools which we will be handling in near future. So this is the graph showing the various 8 essential techniques or gadgets which we'll be using in near future in almost all sectors, out of which we can see the IoT, robotics, and 3D printer are on the top priority. So we'll see one by one how we will handle this. So this is what augmented reality, Internet of Things, drones, cloud computing, 3D printing, virtual reality, robots, and blockchains. So we'll discuss this. I guess all of you are aware IoT or Internet of Things is being used, and we'll see a very fast making growth. It is basically used in the home sector, or we can say in the housing sector and smart cities. The presence of IoT has been felt. So what is IoT? It is nothing but it consists of an ecosystem of sensors, integrated computers, and smart devices that are connected with each other, and a cloud to collect, analyze, and evaluate the data. So what it will help with, it is like we can manage our energy consumptions of the building, we can measure the safety, we can monitor and have the maintenance and repair measures can be optimized with IoT. Thus, it will be a game changer. Next is drones. So drones are the gadgets where human intervention is not possible or it is at risk. So drones basically are, we can say, like the gadgets which can move anywhere at any place. You know, it may be they can fly autonomously, they can climb, they can crawl, they can grasp, they can communicate with each other, and they can give away to one another. They can direct. So this drone, which we can interface with the AR technologies or VR technologies to give a real-time effect. So what are drones? Drones are remote or software-controlled robots used to collect and monitor data from the air. Drone technology captures real-time and 3D modeling data. Drones are equipped with sensors, GPS, or cameras, and can be used for private as well for commercial or military purposes. They are often used in high-risk areas and when a degree of precision is obligatory. Yes, virtual reality. This was more famous or has been greatly used in entertainment or game zones, but it has made its presence felt even in the real estate industry. Virtual reality will be used in the real estate industry, especially in the areas of asset and tenant management, but also in customer relationship management also. The real success, however, will depend on how VR connects to the popular BIM applications and CAD tools or planner software. So these technologies, VR, can be used by property developers to get a 3D 360 degree view of the properties, and we can have the virtual tours of construction for the project, both from inside and outside. So it can be augmented with the mobiles so that we can get and sit at home at a comfort zone and have the site visit without actually having these multiple site visits or going or having a time consuming process. So they are really going to make a mark. Augmented reality. So what is the difference between VR, that is virtual reality, and augmented reality is, here with the help of immersive tools, we can have a real time experience. So augmented reality describes the technologies and applications that link digital data and files to the physical environment so that the user experience a new level. Most applications currently work on mobile devices such as smartphones and tablets, but in future, hands-free devices such as smart glasses will increasingly replace them. The gap between virtual and physical reality is closing nearly. So brands like IKEA, then we have the Urban Ladder app, wherein they have made us available that the spaces we can work on real time with the furniture. So we need not go and have to go to visit the mall or the specific things. So with the help of the tablet or the smartphone, we can actually arrange the furniture sitting at home. So that's the beauty of augmented reality. 3D printing. So this is one of the technology which is going to be a game changers. And as architects, engineers, we have to really make changes into our working style with this 3D printing. This technology is an additive fabrication technique used to create three-dimensional objects. This can be constructed in millimeter precision in digital models by stacking successive material layers. In addition to the production of spare parts for property and facility management, concrete and cement printers have now been developed, and entire houses and bridges can be created. This is a picture of a 3D printed house in Netherlands, which is really, really going to change the picture or the working style, how we should work into near future as architects and as engineers or constructors. Even in our country, Larsen and Taubo has been manufacturing, it's an R&D project, of course, still to go on mass level. So they have made experiments of constructing 3D printing houses. So surely this 3D printing is going to make a mammoth change into the construction industry. The next is new user interface in real estate. New user interface open up with new ways of interacting with people and computer systems, especially when using input devices and software. Recent trends in new user interface include chatbots and interfaces such as Alexa, Google Home, or Apple Siri, which we are all aware of. Even companies are adopting these chatbots connected or interfaced with their website so that they can answer the mundane questions, the day-to-day questions which the customer wants to be answered. So in the real estate industry, the technology is currently used almost exclusively in the smart home sector. Use of services becomes very easy with the help of this new user interface. So I think we have already discussed artificial intelligence in exclusively, but then we can see the four functional categories which it will be into the real estate. That is, one is automated intelligence, where we'll have automated manual cognitive or routine or non-routine tasks, which includes in this. Then we have the supporting intelligence through AI algorithms, which will help people during their work to accomplish tasks in a better and faster manner and with precision. Then expanding intelligence, what we call as, is it will help people to make better decisions, avoiding human errors possibly by giving good decisions. And the lastly is the autonomous intelligence, where automation of decision-making process will be done by machine itself, which is a long affair to go. So artificial intelligence, I think the slides, because of this PDF, are running.
You're at 74.
Yeah, here it is 72.
Some clicking back actually sometimes.
Okay.
Should click ahead.
Okay.
So I think. Ahead,
no? Yeah. I have to go ahead.
74.
Yeah. No, it's not working with the arrow. Fine. Yeah.
Is it? No.
The 71. The 71 slide now it's directly cut. We could have done that with the, I think, presentation only. Okay, no problem.
74-1?
No. Yeah. I've missed some slides, that's what. Yeah, these slides were not done. We directly run into the 3D printing. Virtual reality, we've completed augmented and 3D printing. Yes, blockchain we had missed because of this slip run. Okay, so blockchain is one of the technology which is to be immensely used in the real estate. Blockchain is a decentralized ledger of all transaction through peer-to-peer network. With this technology, subscribers can make transactions without the need for a central certification authority. Possible applications include cash transfers, transaction settlements, and many more. So with the help of smart contracts, it will be possible in the future via blockchain to design rental and purchase contracts to provide and evaluate the necessary data for real estate valuation, to commission service providers along the value chain to map real estate data and to store sensitive data. Yeah, we have done with this. Yeah, cloud computing. So another one is cloud computing, which will, it's like having a repository, just like we have libraries. It will be in near future very difficult to store huge sums of data. So cloud computing in real estate is going to be a rescuer. What it is nothing but a cloud technology can request the resources needed on the internet for web-based tools and application. Businesses using cloud service can store their files and applications on the external servers and access the data over the internet from anywhere in the world, which will really help us to work remotely. So it's nothing but like a repository of the data which is there. Acha nantarchi slide run hot nahiye computing. Okay. So cloud computing in real estate, actually these are the three main service categories, that is infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, or software as a service. So based on the company's need, you can follow any of these categories and avail the service. With the help of the cloud, response speed can be increased, resulting in higher efficiency and service agility, that is time to market. And other advantages are cost savings and flexibility due to the changed IT landscape. So we are done with this.
Yeah,
so I think we have covered all this part, okay. All the technologies.
Yeah.
The mouse work hot nahi hai actually. Okay, it's coming to the last slide only.
This one.
Before that, yeah, it's here. Thank you. So we have seen these eight essential technologies which are there or which will be of greater help to us in future. So despite the predictions of massive job losses, which AI is supposed to say, or people are fearful, I assure you that it is a very overrated statement. AI is unlikely to replace human workforce. Instead, it will alter business model in real estate industry. It will reduce expenses, errors, add speed and efficiency, bring cost effectiveness with these cutting edge technologies. Leaders in the real estate companies should prioritize investment based on areas where AI can have the most impact on their company's unique needs. Early moves will set directions of the industry and benefit in short and long term. So I come to the end of this session with this quote by Albert Einstein. Life is like riding a bicycle. To keep your balance, you must keep moving. So I urge to all the people present over here, whether they are academicians, whether they are working personals, having a large organization or a small consultancy, we should at the earliest embrace these new technologies, which will be of real help to keep us with the current trend of the business models. Yes, can we play the video?
Humans versus machines. This is humans enabled by machines. America can choose to reinvest in a larger set of people and places.
Question for employers is, how do they think about giving their workers a kind of flexibility to do that?
You can take up any questions.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. It was a very enlightening description of artificial intelligence with the streak of philosophical background right from Aristotle. So it's a big eye-opener, and especially a technocrat telling you that humanity is not at the end because of artificial intelligence, but it's a challenge. It's not an ego, it's a challenge. It was a great message you have carried so far. Even participants and myself also, I was worried about how all this is going to connect with real estate. But you have finally explained us how it is really going to matter a lot in the current future. Thanks for a great delivery of such a vast subject where you covered everything and the very important core aspects also. I request all the participants who have been putting messages here about sharing this presentation as well as asking me to explain it more. Please go ahead with your questions. You can either unmute and ask on audio, or you can write down here in the chat so that Madam can answer your question. Session is open for question and answer.
Even right now, if you don't have any questions, surely you can mail me at the first slide which I had projected has my email ID. So if not now, you can feel free to ask me any questions in regard to artificial intelligence and the technology. Surely I'll be sharing with you the references which I've taken for this presentation with you. And I'll pass on it to sir so that he will forward it to you.
Yeah, I have some questions coming.
Yeah.
There are questions coming in. Okay, I'll read it out for you. That is better. This is from Mr. Murli. Question is, can AI be used in all stages of real estate development process? Kindly elaborate on AI in construction phase.
Surely, see, this AI is in its what we say upcoming stage, so it's all experimental. So surely it can be used at the early stages also with VR technologies and AR technologies. You have the drones, so pre-construction stage surely we can use it where human intervention is not possible. So with these kind of technologies we can intervene right from the pre-feasibility stage to the whole life cycle of the project.
There's another question that is from him only, that also kindly elaborate on financial and economical viability AI.
Okay. So currently, it's not it's as not cost effective as it should be. But what mobile played a role 10-20 years back, so which was very a costly affair. Surely, in the coming years, these technologies will be affordable. But right now, yes, it is not possible for everyone to avail these technologies. Only the big companies. For it is possible, but still we can make efforts, small efforts, so that we could afford all these things. So the more it will become popular, the more it will become more affordable and economical for single sole proprietors or small consultancies.
Good evening, ma'am. May I ask a question with your permission?
Yeah, sure.
Ma'am, I'm Kumar Velraja. I'm an assistant professor, Shastra School of Law. Now, regarding this AI, the artificial intelligence may be a greatest technology, but recently I've watched, I've read two important things. Recently, Facebook has discovered that two machines started communicating together. In the beginning stage itself, they have found it and they have disconnected the whole things. It's because they have found that that's the biggest threat. Second one, even in advertisement, it is a funny commercial. A person who's having the artificial intelligence in his residence is living a luxurious life, but due to the climatic conditions changes and couldn't access to get enter into his house. By bringing these artificial intelligence, it might be considered as a biggest technology, but could you is there any assurance that it will safeguard the human beings? Because only the human has to control the machines, but if you're giving the full access, when it controls the entire, so that means start dominating the human beings in a different format. Whether this will bring the greatest, the highest steps for the human's life.
Yes, a very relevant question. I'm also worrying about all these things, whatever the intervention AI is going to make. Definitely, we don't know, or the future is unknown. Rightly, if we had Stephen Hawking, who has predicted that sometimes later, this AI technique will over-smart humans. And maybe because of this, we may even have to leave the Earth. Okay, so we have to keep our plan be ready with us. But these are all predictions, of course, about the Facebook chatbots. If you talk about Alice and Bob's, yes, they were run into a different conversation and some things happen. See, every technology has its own plus and minus points. So here we are talking about the opportunities which AI has to offer. So we can use it smartly for the redundant work where human, we cannot risk human. So human intervention, high risk areas are there. So definitely these will be at rescue. And I personally don't feel that anybody, any machine can ever replace a human. So we'll wait and watch what will happen in future.
Yes, ma'am. And moreover, the thing which I've understood from these sessions, you know, so far 3 day sessions, if I make a chain link connectivity from the day one towards at present artificial intelligence, the way the session was conducted, you know, when we gone through later on, I know the light, lightweight bricks and, you know, M stands and artificial stands. And later on, we have gone for the designs. Now we are you know, standing in the artificial intelligence. So I could feel some kind of connectivity. So when you are constructing any buildings with the proper, you know, the same old age technique, like using the river sands and the bricks and using irons, whether it's a TMT and everything. So by comparison of all these things, you know, the only thing which I felt that whether all these sessions have some kind of connectivity, because we are marching towards the modern technology. So if you want to bring this artificial intelligence, so the construction has to be in a proper design. When it's need a proper design, so we cannot use the proper river sand or the proper bricks and all. So we need some kind of flexibility in the buildings. And so, you know, this is the thing which I felt that. So I felt that all these sessions are having some kind of connectivity, and it's not only dealing with the constructions. So this is what I felt.
So what is the question?
And actually, let me repeat the content from the introduction class and the second sessions. Yeah, when you have gone through the lightweight and the artificial sands, and later on, we have gone through design, artificial intelligence. Don't you think all these things are connected together?
Well, different sessions, yeah. Everything is connected.
Yeah, but then what is the question he wants to? Any questions? Yeah.
His impression.
Yeah. Okay. That's it.
There is another question coming up. Thank you for that, Kumar. This is Lakshmikant Kokate. Can we combine 3D printing in construction and AI? And will this help us to minimize the construction cost and time?
Yes, definitely. Cost presently, it will be a costly affair, but definitely it will be a speedy construction. Lot of R&D is going on into it. The L&T has already started constructing at an experimental level such kind of mass housing projects. So in near future, surely this will replace the traditional conventional methods of constructions will be definitely changed because of this 3D concrete printing. So ambitious projects are going on. At initial levels, yes, the cost will be high, but once it is it will be popularized and it will be done at mass level, surely that cost might come down. Sorry.
Any more questions? Yes, people are thanking you, madam, and they are quite impressed. Yes, it was a very comprehensive description of AI. Any more questions, friends? Feel free. I would like to add something to what Kumar said just now, madam. What he says is right. There is a sort of connectivity in all this. But the words are different, like reality, virtuality, and even augmented reality.
Yeah.
So when you immediately refer to Stephen Hawking was living into all such type of realities, which he imagined many years back. And now slowly we are evolving, and all of us, we are climbing the ladder of our brain evolution. More of the evolution is in the brain rather than in reality. But real estate is some such thing where all the possible results of AI can be visualized more properly with the help of artificial intelligence in real estate, rather than any other virtual achievements of IT sector or Silicon Valley. But it will take a lot of time. We don't know whether we'll be alive till then or not. Very sure. As very rightly madam said, human beings and human brain cannot be so easily replaced by any type of intelligence. With this note, shall we conclude? Any other questions? I can see a very good attendance today. Any other questions? Feel free to ask. Okay. On behalf of Atul Academy, our sponsor, Cyber Family, our trustee, managing trustee, and the team of trustees, our organizing committee, MBA department, and my colleagues, and as a coordinator, on behalf of my participants also, Professor Madhurama Patil, we are very much thankful to you, grateful to you, as you came here and presented this very wonderful topic and gave us a direction in this FDP. It was very nice of you and kind of you to adjust with all our technical weaknesses also. But you explained it very nicely, and you opened a new door towards the knowledge of artificial intelligence. Kindly accept our gratitude, and thank you very much for joining us and giving this opportunity to all such participants who have come from all over India, especially from architecture, engineering, and management discipline, to have this knowledge of artificial intelligence and real estate management. Thanks a lot. Thank you once again. Friends, we are closing now, and as usual, tomorrow's session will be starting from 10, 10:15.